everyone. Welcome to Helping Hands. I'm your host, Alexis Tesner, and I'm here with John George, founder of Detroit Motor City's Blight Busters, which has been going on for 24 years now. And also, John, congratulations, because you recently won Channel 7's Detroit 2020 Award, so kudos. So, John, can you tell me how Blight Busters got started?
Well, certainly. Well, I want to thank you for inviting me and us to your show. We appreciate an opportunity to let the world know what we're doing in Detroit to make it better. I'm a lifelong resident of the city, and about 26, 27 years ago, I moved into the old Redford section there at Grand River and Lasser. Had a young son a couple years later and a daughter on the way. And there was an abandoned house that turned into a crack house, a drug house, and we called the mayor and the police and the city. And for one reason or another, the crack house continued to be a problem, continued to be a drag on the community. One Friday night, it really got out of hand. And, you know, I believe it's a form of child abuse to allow children to grow up in and around that kind of nonsense, that negative energy. So I got up the following morning and went to the hardware store and bought nails and paint and plywood and ended up spending about 8 hours cutting the grass and boarding the house and painting the boards. And a couple neighbors joined me, and we worked pretty much that day. But make a long story short, at the end of that 8 hour effort, when the drug dealers came back, they couldn't get in and they left. And that's how the organization started almost 24, 25 years ago.
Wow, that's impressive. But how did it excel from just one house down the street to leveling blocks of houses and neighborhoods?
Well, it's like anything else, you know, the more you put into it, the more you get out of it. And that first victory, if you will, really encouraged us, kind of put wind in our sails. And Albert Mack and Felix B. Wright were the co-founders of the organization. We're still friends to this day. Matter of fact, Albert still serves on the board. But the point was that it was very simple. A couple, three neighbors got together, spent 8 hours, and we basically took back our neighborhood. And others have joined the fight, and of course it's expanded. Now we have over 10,000 registered volunteers at Blight Busters. We work pretty much Monday through Saturday, 9 to 5. We meet there at the coffee shop. I know you visited us not too long ago, so you know the lay of the land. But the Motor City Java House is the coffee shop that we built there at the Artist Village, along with Alicia Marion, who's the owner, and Chaz Miller, who's our partner in not only cleaning up Detroit, but beautifying it through his public artworks program. So it's really a team effort to bring people together from both the neighborhoods, the city and the suburbs, in an effort to stabilize and revitalize Detroit, mm-hmm. to beautify it, and to create ownership.
That's nice. Together, you and I, we visited the Masonic Temple that you bought from Detroit for just $1. So yes. What are your plans to do with such a big building?
The Masonic Temple was built in 1923. The reason I remember it was the same year my mom was born. But and both the building and my mom will be 90 years old next year, God willing. And that particular property had been vacant for about 15 years. It was a beautiful building, four stories. We bought it from Mayor Young's administration for $1 in August of 95. I like to tell people we paid too much. They should have gave us the dollar. But seriously, it took us 5 years and about $1.4 million to clean out the property, to restore it, and to turn it into a community center focused on bringing resources, volunteers, and projects and programs to our community. And it's really been a great facility. We have run literally thousands of projects and programs from it. And just this past month, we have gone in with our new partner, Tom O'Brien from Reconstruction, Inc. I believe you got to meet Tom when you came for your visit. And Tom and his guys and our guys have been painting and cleaning, and we're putting in new carpet and furniture and equipment. Last month, Michigan State University moved in, Michigan State University Extension, and their staff and volunteers are going to help Blight Busters expand all of our programs there at Grand River and Lasser. As you know, we're also in the process of expanding our urban garden into an urban farm, working with Kofi Royale from Fertile Ground Collective and Public Artworks, Alicia Marion, Java House, and others. We have been able to clear a number of vacant lots that we have planted fresh fruits and vegetables on. And we are expanding the community garden into a project that will be known as Farm City Detroit. We are presently acquiring and removing 7 abandoned homes, a whole city block.
Wow.
And that will allow us in spring of 2013 to expand that garden into an urban farm that'll sprawl two city blocks. We're also in the process of acquiring a property that will serve as the farmhouse and youth training center. So there's much to do and a lot going on, and Michigan State University is going to help us expand that garden program. They're going to be doing nutritional classes in our kitchen at the community center, mm-hmm. and so on. So we're excited that we have another partner in the fight on blight here in the city of Detroit.
That's great. So as you're talking about your community gardens, and I know that you reuse all the material from your houses to build a community garden. So what happens to the vegetables you cook?
Sure.
All of that?
Absolutely. Well, everything that's grown is given away to the students, to the volunteers, to the seniors. You know, when you look at an abandoned home and an abandoned mm-hmm. property, you can look at it two ways. You can say, oh, that's a shame, and it is. But you can also look by organizing yourself in a fashion where you acquire the property, you pull the demolition permit, you properly deconstruct the property, and then you recycle as much of the property as possible. For instance, all the concrete is recycled.
Oh.
90% of the wood, all the hardwood. Matter of fact, the hardwood floors in the Motor City Java House came out of houses that we dismantled.
Wow.
So
nice.
You can also reuse as well as recycle. All of the pine and timber is used to build the boxes and the fencing that we have at our community gardens. We also teach kids in the community how to build tables and chairs and benches and other things. So we can reuse, repurpose a lot of that. And then once that negative energy, that blight, that abandonment is removed, that liability can now become an asset because it can now give instead of take. And so when we plant tomatoes and cucumbers and vegetables and the like, you're creating a community asset. And again, everything that's grown is given away. And it's for the betterment of everyone that lives in that community. And at the end of the day, you know, when you work real hard, you get to eat good. So we're going to encourage others all across the city to clean up their neighborhood and create those community assets.
That's great. That's a great philosophy. So you've been talking about the Motor City Java House, which is owned by your wife, and you just built it for her, which was really nice for you. But
well, you don't want anyone else building a coffee shop for your wife.
So true.
Yes, ma'am.
So what other buildings have you helped, like the Sweet Potato Sensation?
Well, sure.
And
yes.
The candle shop?
Yes. Well, there are a number of businesses within the Artist Village, Motor City Java House being one. But Tonette is the owner of Detroit Candle Company. She joined us last year on Angels Night. And, of course, Angels Night's the time just around Halloween there where the city comes together to patrol and protect it. We actually coined the phrase Angels Night and got Mayor Archer to take it citywide in 96, 97.
Wow.
You know, when you tell a youth for 13 years it's Angels Night, they might do something positive. Mm-hmm. So we have to continue to put a positive spin on everything. But Tonette joined us last year on Angels Night. And Detroit Candle Company has been a welcomed addition there at the village. She not only sells candles and other jewelry and art and clothing that's made in Detroit, but she also has an art camp where she teaches kids and adults how to make their own candles. So it's all part of that creative vein mm-hmm. there at the village, along with Java House and, of course, Chaz and the art. And then you also have to keep in mind that at the village, we have a chess club for the kids on Wednesdays and Saturdays. We teach the kids in our community the strategic game of chess. We have the art camp. We've got the garden program. We've got the youth efforts during the summertime. So there's always something going on there. And of course, on the weekends out back on Saturday night, we do creative juices, which is live jazz, open mic poetry, spoken wow. word. It's a blast. And I strongly suggest you and your audience to come join us
yeah.
any Saturday night right there at the village. But Sweet Potato Sensations is a building and a business owned by our friends right across the street there at Grand River and Losser, kitty corner from the Redford Theater. A number of years ago, I went to see the owner there, Miss Thompson, and she has actually had a very small storefront next to the theater. And I went in to see her, and she was a little upset, and I said, "What's wrong?" She said, "I got to move." I said, "Well, you can't move. You're the sweet potato pie lady. I'll find you a building." So I ran around and I knocked on everybody's door, and I found that the building where they're at now was for sale. And we worked out an agreement with the owner to sell it to her. And then we went in on a Martin Luther King Day with 300 volunteers. And we
wow.
spent, about a week there. And we basically, it was a boarded up, abandoned warehouse, kind of a junky mess. But teamwork is an incredible concept. And with our volunteers on that Martin Luther King Day, we were able to get most of the negative energy out of there. And then we wrote a grant to the county and got her a facade improvement grant for a new face on the building. And then Chaz Miller, our artist, came and painted murals on both sides. And then, of course, their family got a bank loan and put the interior back together. So it was really a team effort between an existing business owner, a couple nonprofits, our volunteers, the county, and others. And we were able to expand her business from about 800 square feet to about 6,000 square feet. So she's hiring more people. She's paying more taxes. It brings more people into the community. And we still have our sweet potato pie at Grand River and Losser. So it was a team effort, and it worked. So those are the kinds of things. You have to be a little creative. And if you can think outside of the box and get others to join the effort, you can make some incredible things happen.
That's great. And you're talking about teams and volunteering. So I want to ask, like, how does someone volunteer and, like, help you out? Because I'm quite interested nonetheless.
Well, we'd love to have you. Bring your friends.
All right.
Everyone's welcome. And everyone's invited. And we have a standing date every Saturday. We meet at the Java House there, 17336 Losser at 9 in the morning. And we work pretty much till 3 or 4 in the afternoon. Then we get set up for Creative Juices, which goes till 3 o'clock the next day. Saturday's a long day for us. But you don't have to call. You don't have to register. Just show up at the coffee shop every Saturday morning. I'll be there. We'll be there. We'll put you to work. Now, if you want to do something Monday through Friday, just give us a call. And we'll schedule a special day for you and your group or any group that would like to participate. You can call the office at 313-255-4355. If no one's there, just leave your name and number. We'll call you back. Or you can always hit us up at www.blightbusters.org. Leave your information, your name, your number, how many people you'd like to bring, what day you'd like to come, and we'll get back with you, and we will design an effort just for you and your group.
Oh, that's so sweet. But on volunteering, I heard that corporations come in and help you.
They
so
do.
Tell
yes.
me about that.
By the busload. We've had volunteers in. Like I said, we have over 10,000 registered volunteers that we work with on an annual basis. It's probably one of the most aggressive volunteer efforts launched in the city of Detroit over the last 25 years. We're very, very, very serious about taking our community back and creating the kind of neighborhood we can be proud of. So everybody from Google to Ford Motor, Chrysler, GM, Starbucks has just been incredible. They came out with 300 volunteers earlier this year. Craig Russell, the VP, and his son joined us a couple weeks later. But we kicked off the Farm City project. We were tearing down garages and ripping out fences and pulling out driveways and painting murals and helping little old ladies across the street. And we were just having a good old time. But yes, Starbucks is another example. Comcast, Carhartt, Comerica.
Wow.
They're lining up behind us and the city. You know, we as a people, all people, we have to learn to put our petty differences aside and focus in on things that are going to benefit the whole region. Mm-hmm. When you look at a world map, it just says Detroit. It doesn't matter if you're from Farmington or West Bloomfield or Ferndale. We have got to understand that people in regions are judged by the company they keep. It's in everyone's best interest to have a clean, decent central city. And in this region, it's Detroit. Mm-hmm. So whatever differences we have to learn to get over it and around it and beyond it. Our children need us to focus on rebuilding the core city here. And in this region, it's Detroit.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So you're talking about Chad Miller, who's your...
Chaz Miller. C-H-A-Z-Z, right.
Yep. And he does all of your art, and he's working on the butterfly effect
yes.
throughout Detroit. So I was wondering if you could tell us more about that.
Well, Chaz is an incredible individual, very talented, warm heart, just a great guy. And we met Chaz 9 years ago, and when we met Chaz, he said he wanted to teach kids and paint murals. And at the same time, we were looking for a building to build the coffee house. So when the village became available, it was pretty simple to see how Chaz and his art and his desire to teach kids and paint murals would go along with the coffee and Alicia's effort to have a neighborhood coffee shop. And I have a bad habit of buying old dusty buildings, so it was kind of three people's visions coming together. But one of Chaz's projects is the butterfly effect. And what that is exactly is we've been gathering surplus wood from some of the demolitions and other places. And he's in the process of creating over 1,000 butterflies. They're about yay big. And they're painted by the thousands and thousands of volunteers that come. So each one's kind of like snowflakes. Each one's a little bit different, right? So what we do is when Blightbusters goes into a neighborhood to create a pocket park, or if we clean up a park, or if we board up an abandoned house, Chaz comes in and decorates it. He's kind of the icing to the Blightbusters cake. So not only do we stabilize the neighborhood and clean it up, but we also beautify it. And Chaz's goal is to have over 1,000 of these butterflies all across the city. And if you look at a butterfly, you know, it starts out as a little ugly worm, pretty much. And it's really a metaphor for the city. The city's kind of ugly right now. And and it needs to kind of get up off its knees and fly again. So the butterfly effect is really that effort that Chaz has undertaken to spread a little beauty, spread a little what we call Detroit love, and to get people to kind of pay attention to the fact that there are many, many people all across the city doing things that will ultimately help the city come back.
Oh, that's great. And he's also doing mood swings too, yes, isn't he?
Yes. Chaz says Detroit needs a mood swing, and I agree with him. And what he's doing is taking surplus and recycled material and building these huge, colorful swings. And some of them have solar panels on them, so you can recharge your cell phone. Others really? Have little radios on them. Yeah, they're pretty neat. And they're also very colorful and has that artistic value to it, if you will. And those mood swings pop up at bus stops and at downtown at the river and at campus marshes. So you'll never know when you'll see a mood swing, but Detroit is in the middle of a major mood swing to positive things.
That's great. So we talked about, you know, you helping the community, helping kids, you know, do activities and stuff. So I want to talk more on you, John. Like, what do you feel every single time when you tear down a building and it's fresh, it's a new start? Like, how do you do what you do?
Well, first off, what I do is not a job. It's really a lifestyle. They couldn't afford to pay me all the hours that I work on this. If I'm awake, I'm working on making Detroit better. I could just about assure you. And I love what I do. I love bringing diverse groups of people together, first off, from the city and the suburbs, and create friendships and build bridges and create solution. Blightbusters has always been an ambassador. We're not blaming anyone. We don't think we're better than anyone. We don't. All we want to do, quite frankly, is bring everyone together, make Detroit better, and create homeowners and business owners and opportunities for our children. There's no other agenda. You know, a lot of times people will come down and say, "Well, what are you doing?" You know, and they look for some kind of ulterior motive. Yeah. There isn't one. We are deadly serious about bringing people together, rebuilding our community, making it safe and sound, and making it beautiful. But there's a sense of, obviously, satisfaction when we eliminate negative energy, or we hand the keys to a single mom for her new home or her new car or whatever we might do to help. There are certainly some lows and some highs, you know. Financing's kind of like this, you know.
Yeah.
And it is a challenge. It's probably the most challenging thing that I've ever done. Matter of fact, I know it is, besides raising my children. But, and that's really why I started the organization. I didn't want my kids growing up in and around crap. I don't want others' children to grow up in and around that negative energy. So as adults, as concerned citizens, as parents, we have a responsibility to our seniors, to our children, to do better. So when we finish one project, believe me, there are many, many more. So we kind of have a little bit of a celebration, and then we go right back to work. So again, it's a team effort. And there is power in teamwork.
That's great. Are there any like upcoming projects that you guys are doing, something big for everyone?
Well, certainly. As you know, the Farm City Detroit project is in full swing. And our goal this year is to clear all 7 of those abandoned homes. And we're right in the middle of that as we speak. That project runs Monday through Saturday, pretty much 9 to 5. And beyond that, we are going to continue the restoration work there at the Artist Village. We're doing the lofts upstairs. We're going to be building a deck in the courtyard. So that's an ongoing effort. We're also, of course, working there at the Resource Center. And, of course, Myers is going to be building a $33 million Myers at Grand River and Six Mile. And just this summer, we started the demolition work there at that site. So by the end of this year, the old Redford High School will be gone. And in 2013, we'll be celebrating the grand opening of a new $33 million Myers in our community. So we're very excited. And we're going to do anything that we can do to continue to bring people together, continue to clean up the city, and continue to create homeowners and opportunity.
That's great. So people just come to you for like, oh, I need a building to tear down. Where's John?
Well, I must admit, we've caused a bit of a panic at Grand River and Lasser in a good way. What I mean by that is people, when you come to that neighborhood like you witnessed and felt, I mean, it's one thing for me to tell you, it's another thing for me to show you. And then you get it. You understand that it's not just me all by myself. We have a team. We have a deep bench with a lot of talent. And there are others like me that believe that our best days are ahead. So we have to continue to bring people together. We have to continue to rally the resources, and we have to continue to coordinate the projects and programs that will make Detroit better.
That's great. And I mean, you've met a lot of successful people, Obama, Oprah, anyone else in particular?
Well, we've met some really unbelievable folks. Of course, President Obama was a real honor to meet with him and talk with him briefly. And of course, I was on the Oprah Winfrey Show, and I want to thank her again for that great Volkswagen she gave me, which I gave to my wife.
Aww, but,
and all the other stuff I gave to my daughter. But the bottom line is, it's just stuff. And we just appreciate the message getting out. Again, if you know what we're doing, you have an opportunity to join us. You can volunteer. You can donate a used car, or if you have a home in Detroit that you no longer want, we take those and recycle those houses, as you know. Or cash contributions. There are so many different ways people can come to help us help the city. And we're always looking for new soldiers in the fight. So if anyone wants to help us in any kind of way, they can call us again at 313-255-4355 to either volunteer or to donate or to get help. If there's something that we can do to help, we want to do that.
That's great. So you guys are, is it just the old Redford district, or are you guys slowly moving out into more of Detroit?
Well, clearly 80% of our work is at the Grand River Lasser Northwest Core. Mm-hmm. But we've worked on projects on the east side, southwest Detroit, north end. Earlier this year, we went about 10 miles from our community center and tore down a garage for a little old lady that was leaning in her backyard, and she didn't have the money, and her health wasn't very good. So we went in with a team and eliminated the blight. So yes, we do spread the love a little bit. We do take the show on the road. Earlier this year, we worked with Mary Grove College over there at Myers and 6 Mile. So we do get out to other points, but clearly 80% of our work is in the old Redford Brightmoor community.
Great. One thing that I want to touch up on that you mentioned earlier is, I mentioned earlier, was that you create a lot of beautiful things in the city, and you created the Peace Temple. And I was wondering if you could tell me a little short story on
that. One of my favorite projects. We met a gentleman named David Bess, an artist from California, and David creates these beautiful temples. They're made out of laser-cut plywood, and they're absolutely gorgeous. But on this particular site was an abandoned house. It was a crack house that had been firebombed. So we went in with volunteers from Ford Motor Company a number of years ago and eliminated the negative energy. And then David Bess came along and he said he wanted to build a temple. I said, well, hey, I got a spot for you. It's right next to our community center. It's right in downtown Old Redford. Let's build it here. So we got together, and there was a couple that came every day to help us work on this temple. We probably had 30, 40 people kind of coming and going, and we set up a little tent city there next to the parking lot with a DJ and a barbecue pit, and so we worked about 12 hours a day for 7 days, and this one couple kept coming, and I couldn't figure out why they were working so hard. Right, I mean, everybody was working hard, but these guys were really working double time. So we got done on a Saturday at noon, and at 3 o'clock this couple ended up getting married at the temple. So it's how we kind of christened our Peace Temple, and it's really been a great addition to the community, all parts of the arts and the beautification. But not only do people get married there, we've had barbecues and garage sales and poetry readings and jazz concerts. So it's really become the center of that neighborhood, and it continues to serve. And as a matter of fact, we just added a group called the Detroit Bartenders, and what that is, it's a youth group that teaches kids calisthenics. They do push-ups and pull-ups and other things there. It's kind of their site now. And they've added some chin-up bars. I tried all that stuff. I almost killed myself. But the point is, it's another project of Blight Busters where we teamed up with an artist and artists, and we eliminated that negative energy and put something more positive there that gives back to the community. So we're going to continue to reinvest in the city, invite people in, create opportunity and ownership.
That's great. And it's really good that you want to take out the negative and put in the positive. And is there any, as the show's coming to an end, is there anything else you want to add about the Blight Busters?
Well, I got to say, it's been quite an adventure. I've met people from literally all over the globe. And at the Village, as we say, is where the world meets, because mm-hmm. literally people from all walks of life have come. We even had the president's fellows come last year mm-hmm. along with City Year. And I want to thank not only them, but all the volunteers, all the corporate sponsors, all of the organizations, all of the people that love the city and have supported our effort over the last 24 years. And I just want all of them to know that Blight Busters, its board, its staff, we're going to redouble our efforts, and we're going to continue to bring people together. We're going to continue to stabilize and revitalize and beautify this city. And I believe our best days are yet to come. We just have to learn how to put our petty differences aside, focus, and work together on things that are going to benefit all of us.
That's great. Well, thank you for having us on Helping Hands, and we can't wait to see you next time.